All right, we've got everybody up now. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for our commemoration of National Former Prisoners War Recognition Day. My name is Lindsay Davis. I'm the Visitor Engagement Coordinator here at Soldiers Memorial Military Museum. Though we are a few days off from the April 9th date, we really appreciate you guys coming out to honor our former POWs, especially today's speaker, Colonel William Reich. Before we jump into the program, I have a few quick housekeeping announcements, mostly for those of us joining on Zoom. Just so you guys know, it's approximately a 30 to 40 minute presentation today, followed by some time for Q&A. We welcome Q&A both from our in-person audience, as well as from those of you joining us on Zoom. If you're on Zoom, note that the Q&A button is in the toolbar. Of course, we encourage questions from both of our audiences. Please know that we'll do our best. We may not have time to answer every question that we get today. Today's presentation is being recorded, so if you'd like to view it again later, share it with family and friends. It will soon be available on the Missouri Historical Society's YouTube channel. And now I'd like to introduce Paul Dillon to you. Paul is the president of the forthcoming Jefferson Barracks POW MIA Museum here in St. Louis, as well as the son of a former prisoner of war, Richmond Red Dillon, who served and was held captive during World War II. Paul will provide a quick history of the National Former Prisoner of War Recognition Day before we hand it over to Dillon Ellen.
Thank you, Lindsay, and good afternoon, everyone. Many of you are probably already aware of or are familiar with National POW MIA Recognition Day. It was established by presidential proclamation in 1979 by President Jimmy Carter. It is always observed on the third Friday in September. And it came about mainly because of the tireless efforts of our Vietnam veterans. And over the years, it has come to be associated with the new Heisley designed POW MIA flag and the missing man table ceremony. And it continues to play a major role in shedding light on the plight of our MIAs and their families. Less known is National Former Prisoner of War Recognition Day. It was established in 1988 by President Ronald Reagan, also by presidential proclamation, 3 years after the authorization of by Congress of a prisoner of war medal. And it is always observed on April 9th. And the significance of April 9th is that it is on that day in 1942 that the Bataan Peninsula fell to the Japanese, and about 13,000 Americans and about 60,000 plus Filipinos were taken as prisoners of war. It was the largest number of Americans ever captured on any single day. And it was also the beginning of the infamous Bataan Death March, a brutal 65-mile force march from the tip of the Bataan Peninsula inland towards Camp O'Donnell. Camp O'Donnell was a Philippine army camp that the Japanese turned into a POW camp. It is estimated that between 7,000 and 10,000 prisoners of war who made that march either died or were killed by the Japanese. The establishment of a National Former Prisoner of War Recognition Day is the result in part by the efforts of our former prisoners of war, their families and friends, and the American Ex-Prisoners of War organization. It is also linked to their efforts over the years to have a prisoner of war medal authorized by Congress. From World War I to the present day, there have been about 142,000 Americans taken as prisoners of war. Interest in the authorization of a prisoner of war medal began as far back as 1944, when the scale and the scope of the atrocities taking place to our POWs in the Pacific, as well as what was happening to our prisoners of war in the European theater, became more and more known. The Department of Defense, our War Department, as it was known back then, amazingly as it seems, was against the establishment of a prisoner of war medal. Their reasoning or their objections were twofold. One, they thought that there were already enough awards and decorations in place to take care of any actions that the POWs may take. And number two, and probably the main reason, was that they thought that awards and decorations were intended as to reward and to provide an incentive for higher achievement. And they didn't see how being captured or held as a prisoner of war or surrendering met that criteria. When the Korean War hostilities ended in 1953, atrocities such as the Suncheon Tunnel Massacre and others committed by the North Koreans against our prisoners of war came to light and became the subject of an intense congressional hearings. In 1968, the USS Pueblo and its crew was seized in international waters by North Korea. And again, Americans were subjected to similar brutal psychological and physical mistreatment. The treatment Commander Lloyd Bucher, skipper of the Pueblo, received at a US Navy Court of Inquiry was deemed by many not much better than the treatment he received being interrogated by the North Koreans. And in 1971, legislation was introduced in the Congress for the creation of a prisoner of war medal, but it was not passed. In 1973, Operation Homecoming saw the return of our prisoners of war being held by the North Vietnamese. Stories of their mistreatment and the torture and brutality inflicted upon them became widespread. In 1975, our involvement in Vietnam ended and legislation was again introduced into Congress for the creation of a prisoner of war medal. And again, it did not pass. In 1981, several months after the Iran hostage crisis ended, legislation for a prisoner of war medal was once more proposed and once more failed to pass. It was tried again unsuccessfully in 1983. With the seeming unlikelihood of a prisoner of war medal ever being approved, in 1984, former prisoners of war belonging to the American Ex-Prisoners of War Organization petitioned Congress for the creation of a prisoner of war medal and for the establishment of a national former prisoner of war recognition day. It had been almost 40 years since World War II, about 31 years since the Korean War ended, and 9 years since America's involvement in Vietnam. So the appearance and testimony before Congress and other venues of these former prisoners of war, some of them with walkers in wheelchairs, and some of them wearing their bronze stars and their purple hearts, and their silver stars and their distinguished flying crosses and their Navy crosses and their CIB badges, telling their story that it's not always with weapons that you struggle against an enemy or adversity. Their stories were pretty hard to ignore. And in 1985, legislation introduced by Senator Barry Goldwater for the establishment of a prisoner of war medal was finally passed. Still, amazingly enough, without the support of the Department of Defense. Then in April of 1988, President Ronald Reagan, by presidential proclamation, formally instituted National Former Prisoner of War Recognition Day. A little bit about the American Ex-Prisoners of War Organization. It was founded in 1942 by two moms whose sons had been captured when Bataan fell. And when Mrs. Charles Bickford and Mrs. Fred Landon found out about the inhumane treatment our prisoners of war were receiving at the hands of the Japanese, they formed the Bataan Relief Organization, or the BRO. They formed the organization in an attempt to get medicine and food to our prisoners of war there in the Pacific. These attempts were mostly unsuccessful, but what the organization did, it formed an important conduit of information and support to the families and the loved ones of our prisoners of war who were being held in the Pacific. When World War II ended, the organization stayed intact and became the Bataan Veterans Organization, providing much needed help and aid to our Bataan veterans and to their families. And it also provided support for those prisoners of war dealing with the difficulty and the trauma of having been held as a prisoner of war. By 1959, this difficulty and trauma was recognized that all of our prisoners of war were having to deal with it. And the organization changed its name to the American Ex-Prisoners of War. And all those Americans who had ever been held as prisoners of war or interned were invited to become members. And the organization grew to include multiple American ex-prisoners of war chapters in every state and territory of the nation. They were a strong lobbying organization for our veterans and for our former prisoners of war. And although the passage of time has done to its membership what the enemy could not, the organization is still actively involved in the legacy of our former POWs. Its national headquarters is located in Arlington, Texas, and I stand before you a proud next of kin member of that organization. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much for that introduction, Paul. Now I'm going to hand it on over to today's speakers, Bill and Ellen Reich. Okay, so how we're handling today's program is interview style. So I'll be asking some questions to Bill and Ellen. I'm gonna go ahead and unmute them right now. One moment. Okay, so first and foremost, Bill, what led you to become a pilot?
Well, in my case, that's kind of an interesting story. I was a good student in high school. I had very high grades. I had very high SAT scores. I was a national scholar. So I started getting lots of the material from colleges and universities suggesting I come to their school. Well, I didn't pay any attention to it until late my junior year. I was constantly talking to him and said, hey, when are you going to start thinking about where you're going to go to college? And no thought, I think that was my folks. My dad had a comfortable middle class job, but I didn't think I would have to do my homework at school with scholarships. So when I sat down in the guidance council, I said, well, I remember years ago I read a National Geographic about this new school called Air Force Academy on Colorado Springs. And I thought, you mean they need to go to school? No tuition. So that kind of coincidence. It turns out was named the outstanding liaison officer of the year, like 6 years running. So once I hooked up with him, it was like I had no other options in the Air Force Academy. And so the very first time that I rode on an airplane was to go down to Texas for my initial basic training. So I really had no thought of being a pilot up to that point. But through the years at the academy, of course, you had the opportunity to fly on an airplane. It kind of grew on you, you know, just kind of, you know, this is kind of fun. Of course, in my case, I'm 6 foot seven, which means I'm qualified to be a pilot in the Air Force. I don't need the city either. But the tradition at the academy was they always waive that so you go to pilot training. Well, in my case, they decided for the first time that too many academy grads were going to pilot training and they needed to spread them out on other things. So they just refused to administrate the process my waiver. So I ended up going to NAV school instead. And when I graduated high in my NAVSCO class, which allowed me to pick an M4 as my airplane fly. So initially, I was a navigator, but I was a navigator on a fighter aircraft, which is a two-man aircraft. I was a backseater. That's what it was. It got shot down. But after coming back from Vietnam, they asked me, well, what do you want to do in the Air Force? Well, not a lot. And my two choices I was considering was go to medical school or go to pilot training. I decided that I enjoyed taking the backseat of the pilot training. So they sent me to pilot training. That's how I ended up being the command pilot at the Air Force. Well, we went to the same high school. We started dating. That's what? In the band together, so we had a lot of things in common. So I guess you could say we were high school sweethearts.
Fantastic. So Ellen, next question's for you. What went through your mind when you found out that Bill was being sent overseas?
Well, through our life dating, he had told me that Vietnam would be over before here. And no one expected it was going to last 12 long years. So when we're finished with airport training in California, he got an assignment to Korea. And I was relieved. Yay, he wasn't going to be in a war zone. But I knew that he wanted to get the advantages that being a fighter pilot would give him in a war. So I wasn't surprised when he traded with someone to go to New Dorn, Thailand. And from New Dorn, then he would be flying missions into Vietnam. And he told me, it'll just be bombing bridges and military installations. You know, don't worry about it. So with that, we packed up our belongings and I headed back to Wisconsin to live with my parents. And he went off to New Dorn.
I'm going to remember to unmute myself.
Ellen actually sort of answered that question. In my mind, I'm thinking, well, if I'm going to go to Korea, it's a one-year remote tour away from my family. So why spend it in Korea? And I really thought that my Vietnam War would have been over before I had a chance to get over there either. I thought, in my mind, I'm thinking, if I'm going to be away from my family for a year, that's what I'm doing in combat and get the combat experience. Because that's clearly, at that time, I was still looking at a career in the Air Force. And that would certainly be a plus on my record, just the experience of that. So as Ellen said, I talked to one of my F4 classmates, and he was agreeable to swap assignments. So that's what we did.
So, what was a typical day like when you were in New Dorn?
It was get up in the morning, fly, you know, refly, go back, eat, refly again, come back, eat. If you had enough time before you had to go into crew rest, you'd fly a third time. And that was pretty much every day. I always thought it was kind of interesting that usually eat my meals in the officer's club. And then there was a sign in the entrance of the officer's club that told you what day of the week was. Not that it was March 21st or 22nd, but that it was Tuesday or Wednesday. Because you found out after a while, every day was exactly the same, and you couldn't remember which day of the week it was. And the only time that really changed at all was before we started flying north again, I got on the night schedule. And I kind of enjoyed night flying, but the problem with the night schedule, because of crew rest requirements, and it's tough to get off the night schedule. But that was pretty much the same as the day schedule, except the day instead of starting at 6 a.m., the day started about 3 p.m. And a typical mission that we flew quite a few times there was you took off with your load of bombs, contacted a airborne controller, and dropped bombs somewhere in South Vietnam, landed at Benoit Airfield in South Vietnam, got new bombs, grabbed a cup of coffee and a little bit to eat, went out, dropped bombs in South Vietnam again, went back to airfield again in South Vietnam, put on bombs, dropped bombs in South Vietnam, went back to a third time, put bombs on the airplane, dropped bombs. And after the third time, you were pushing your crew rest again, so then you caught a tanker and went back to Udo. That was a pretty typical day. And even after we started flying north again, usually that took enough time, you could only do that once or twice a day. But other than that, the schedule really never changed the whole time I was there.
So that being said, how about you talk us through the day that your plane was shot down?
Okay. When the North Vietnamese regular army invaded South Vietnam, we started going north. We started bombing into North Vietnam. Because up until that time, we weren't allowed to bomb in North Vietnam. We just never got up there. But after they took the gloves off and we started going north again, I was we had eight air crews in my squadron, a triple nickel, that were designated as air-to-air superiority air crews. So we didn't go on bombing missions like most of the guys. We went as escort airplanes until they got to the target. And we would cap over the North Vietnamese airfields to keep the Mings away. And you were always paired with the same pilot, normally. I was the number two aircraft. In a four ship, aircraft one through four, I was always my pilot. We were always in number two, except the day I got shot down. The day I got shot down, the flight move. Was a guy named Joe Kittinger. Some of you heard of him. He's the guy that jumped out of the balloon back in 1960 and set all the records for all that. But anyway, he was not one of the best air-to-air pilots normally because he was too senior. But he decided to extend his tour, and he decided that he wanted to fly. Big day who go forth that day, so he was the lead pilot number one, and he saw who the backseater was that he was going to fly with. He said, "I don't want to fly with him. I want to fly with Tiny." Tiny was my call sign in the Air Force because of my height, and so they just swapped us around, and so we had all kinds of weather delays, so the mission got off really late. But we finally took off about 2 in the afternoon to head north of Vietnam. North Vietnam. So we did our strike escort. We got up over North Vietnam, close to Yen Bai Airfield, which is the big airport right in the city of Hanoi. And so we left the guys that were strike escorting because they were starting their bombing missions. And about that time, the North Vietnamese launched their Things to do whatever they wanted to do. So we're in the process of intercepting some MiGs, and I remember seeing them out in front of us, several of them. It's kind of interesting because, for whatever reason, the North Vietnamese MiG-21s mostly, they just painted them, I guess they painted them whatever color the pilot wanted the color. So there were green ones, there were red ones, there were blue ones. Ones I really didn't understand, and the guys didn't paint their airplanes at all because that made them real shiny. The sun glinted off of them, made them really easy to see. But anyway, so we're engaged with, so we started to engage with a couple of weeks about tennis. And we get a little bit separated. And this day, officially, we were shot down by another big with an air-to-air missile. I don't know for sure, but there was a lot of indications that I saw in the cockpit shortly before we got hit that would suggest that maybe, just maybe, we got shot down by our number two guy. because he had announced that he had locked onto a target. And I got indications in our airplane that it looked like an F-4 radar had locked onto us. And he did fire a missile. We don't know for sure. Like I said, officially that didn't happen. But anyway, so when all this happened, we were at about 22,000 feet and we're doing about Mach 1.3. Well, it's aerophysics that a supersonic airplane will not stall, no matter what, how steep your angle of attack, it will not stall. So I brought a small F-4 for using for people that don't know what it looks like, and I'll try to explain. So this is an F-4. Missile hits us back here in the tail somewhere. And this thing here in the back is called a stabilator. Well, it goes full down, and it's what controls the pitch of the airplane. When it goes full down, the airplane immediately pitches up like this. And I worked for Boeing before I retired. So I talked to an aero expert to kind of describe the conditions, and he could estimate how many G's we pulled just mathematically. And his estimate was we pulled about 16 G's instantaneous. Okay, so what that caused to happen, this is where the radar resides in the radar dome. Well, as we pitched up, that just fell off. Radar fell off. Things. And as we continued to pitch up, this section in the back is called the boat tail. It broke off and fell away. The engines lay in the bottom of the airplane line like this. And so when the airplane pitched up, the engines ripped off their mounts, and they just kept going the way they were going originally. So they were just two engines kind of going across the sky. And as the airplane continued to pitch up, the wings are what create the lift. And they're designed to be flexible. But they put such a load on the wings, and I can describe all this, not because I experienced it at the time, but much later I was able to talk to the pilot of the 3 airplane. He saw all this happen, so he explained it to me. So as the airplane pitched up, the wings bent so much that he thought they were going to curl around and touch the wingtips. Of course, just before they almost touched, of course, they broke off, so they separate from the airplane. And in addition, it broke the spine of the airplane right about here in the middle, and so it exposed all the fuel bags, and they split open, and they all caught fire. So by the time the airplane goes around half a revolution, the only thing that's left of it is the cockpit area, of which still contains the pilot and me, and we're inside this huge fireball. Said it just looked like a meteor going across the sky. Well, inside the airplane, my inertia reel failed. Inertia reel is sort of like seat belts. They're designed to keep you upright, and they're loose normally, so you can move back and forth. But if they're turned suddenly, they lock like a seat belt. And then the mine failed because it was so intense it actually broke them. So I don't remember actually getting hit, but very quickly, I'm basically, my face is up against the instrument panel, kind of my chest is kind of bowed on my knees, and my visor is shattered because it smashed into it. And I couldn't sit up, but I didn't know why. I knew something was wrong. I was trying to sit up, but I didn't know why. Well, of course, the reason why is because the airplane is still going on like this, and it's still got a high G load on it, and I saw the orange glow of the fireball we were outside. And I still remember very clearly the first thing that came to my mind was, it looks just like it did when I was a kid, and my dad used to burn the leaves in the fall in the driveway. So that didn't make any sense. At some point, of course, the front seater, his inertia reel did work, so he's still sitting upright, and he knows that the airplane is basically disintegrating around him. But the G-forces kind of got his hands pinned to his side, so he told me he was trying to get his hands on the ejection handle, so he could eject, but he couldn't lift his hands up. So we go around a couple of times. Well, they realized as they went around, the airplane was also wobbling off to the sides a little bit. And we kind of time it. The G would load up, lighten up just a little bit, and then begin again. So he kind of timed it. Slowly, he got two fingers in his thumb around the right hand, around the injection handle, and his lower handle on the pull. And that initiated the sequence. So the pilot injects and you go on the go. And I will forever give credit to Martin Baker, which is a English company, British company that made the ejection seats. How reliable that seat was, because it's a real gold bar type design. Everything has to happen in sequence. If you break the sequence anywhere, the whole thing stops, and then you got to try to make it work manually. Well, I was in no shape to do that. But it all, despite all this damage to the airplane, that seat worked just the way it was supposed to. So out the airplane I go. And then, but I knocked unconscious in the ejection. And so when I wake up again, I'm already hanging in the chute coming down. There's five steps that you're supposed to do right after the ejection. And the first step is to check your canopy. To do that, you got to reach your arms up on the risers and look up. Well, I found out I couldn't raise my arms up. And I didn't really know why, but I couldn't raise them up. What I didn't know at the time is my right arm was broken right at the ball and socket. My shoulder, my left arm was dislocated. So I just couldn't lift them up. And I couldn't do the first step, so I promptly forgot the next four steps. So I started looking around. I didn't see Colonel Ginger anywhere. I didn't know where he was. I did see a little bit of smoke trail from the airplane. I couldn't see where it crashed. And I started noticing this flickering out of the corner of my eye. And so I looked down because I thought maybe somebody was shooting at me. Well, as I focused on it, I realized that I had a big cut that had opened up my left hand completely. Blood was down my hand. So I thought, well, okay, it's time to get my survival radio and try to talk to one of the guys about what my condition is and where I am and everything. And the survival vests that we had were quite old. So the zippers didn't work very well. I tried to soak them up and keep them working. I was having a hard time getting my zipper open. Get at my radio, set the frequency, and I realized that my left hand was doing everything my brain was telling me to do to try to get the zipper open, but my right hand wasn't doing anything at all. It was just laying there. You know, my fingers weren't even touching. And I just remember, well, that's kind of weird. And then I pass out again. Okay, and I didn't wake up again until I was already on the ground. North Vietnamese, as it turned out, I came down close to probably less than a half a mile from a small army outpost of the regular North Vietnamese army. So by the time I got conscious, they were already there trying to police me up. Apparently, they didn't understand zippers very well because they were trying to get my G-suit off, and you can't get it off without loosening the zippers. And so, and I was kind of faking like I was still unconscious. And one of these guys holds out this big machete. I mean, it's about 3 feet long. And they use it sort of like a can opener. They slide it down underneath the G-suit next to my leg and kind of just cut the G-suit off. So they basically stripped me down to my underwear. And they were gonna carry me down there because there was eight of them. So they were gonna carry me down back to the post where they had a vehicle parked. And so they had these four bamboo poles, and they put one under my neck, one under the small of my back, one under and under my butt, and one kind of under my knees. And they each picked me up, you know, one guy on the side of the pole, and they picked me up that way to carry me down. Well, the guys by my legs, they kind of held onto my feet so I wouldn't slide off the poles. But the guys with the poles under my small my back and under my neck, they didn't hold on to me. So as soon as they picked me up, I slid off the poles and they kind of dropped me on my head. So they sat me down and they put the poles back in the place and they started to pick me up the same way. And they dropped me on my head again. So the third time I go, okay, it's time to wake up. You know, I'm awake because these guys aren't figuring it out. I don't want to go through this a third time. So I got up and I could walk. I knew I had done something in my right knee. And I landed on the ground unconscious because it was swollen about double size and it was painful to walk on it, but I could walk slowly. So they took me to this Jeep. And then probably the most interesting thing at that point is we drove around the little villages, and we did this five times, okay? But we drove around to this village and they would stop the Jeep right in the middle of the village. And the four guys that were in the Jeep with me, three of them were carrying AK-47s. So the guy in charge appeared to have a weapon. But they would stop the Jeep in the middle of town, and the people in the village would kind of come out to see what was going on. And they were obviously just curious. There was no real hostility or anything. But the soldier in charge would start talking to them. All of a sudden, they start getting angry and they start picking up sticks and they picked up rocks and that. And they walk right up to the Jeep and they're beating up these sticks and they're throwing the stones at me from like 2 feet away. It's like, what's going on here now? And this went on for maybe 2 or 3 minutes. And I looked at the soldier in charge and he's over there lighting up a cigarette. He kind of smokes a cigarette. And then he says something in Vietnamese, and I don't know what he said, but all of a sudden the other three soldiers with the guns, they start pushing the villagers away from me, like they're protecting me. And they're not being gentle about it either. So they push them away, and then they take me into a house, a room, and they set me down and ask me if I want a cigarette. And they give me a cup of what I thought at the time was hot water, but it turns out it was tea. It was just very weak tea. And then we get back in the Jeep. And we went through this routine. Like I said, we went through this routine 5 times, exactly the same in every village. And I don't know to this day what that was all about. Relatively small remote villages, so maybe they were just getting people engaged in the war. I don't know. So then we started driving somewhere at the time, of course, I didn't know initially. Eventually, we stopped in another vehicle that had Colonel Kittinger in it. They had a nice Polaroid land camera, and they took pictures of us. And we got back in the trucks. That was probably the first time I was a little bit worried about dying because the roads were basically dirt gravel roads. And they had these huge, huge trees on each side of the road where the roots sometimes grew right out in the road. The road was most of the time, it's only about 3.5 wide. The Jeep and I was in the view behind the truck that the colonel was in, so we're eating their dust all the time. So the other soldiers are trying to get the driver to go fast and pass the truck so we'll be in front. Well, he doesn't have, vehicle can't accelerate all that well, so when he got an open spot where he thought he could pass, he could step on the gas. But before he could complete the passing, we'd see one of these trees with the lips way out of it. I mean, I'm talking about roots that are like 2 feet in diameter, and you couldn't hit one of those. So he slammed on the brakes and get back behind the truck. I was just waiting for him to misjudge and roll the truck. But eventually we got to the Hanoi, and I got out of it because I was blindfolded this whole time until that. they took the blindfold off and got out of the truck. We were at the front end of the Wallow prison, which I recognize the doorway. I'd seen pictures of it. The Wallow prison is the Vietnamese name.
Thank you. Yeah, I hate to interrupt because that's a fascinating story, but I think it'd be great to check in with Ellen and find out how did you figure out Bill's status? What were you hearing from the government?
As I said, we were in Wisconsin in a small village living with my parents. And I was out washing the car because it was May 11th and it was time to get the salt off the car. And I see this blue sedan drive up, and I knew that this was not something usual in our community. And this Air Force officer gets out of the car, and immediately I felt like running the other direction because I knew that the news he was going to communicate was not going to be good. But I mustered up all the courage I could and went up to him, and he said that Bill's plane had been shot down. He gave me some hope. He said that two chutes had been seen and there was a garbled message that had been sent. And he gave me a number in Texas at command headquarters that I could call. And Bill had prepared me for something like this. He said, if he's ever shot down, they will send out a rescue and search and rescue mission to pick him up. So in those early days of not knowing what had happened, I was calling Texas frequently, and come to find out the two chutes sighting was not confirmed, and nor was the garbled message. So my days went from just kind of marking time, waiting for him to get home in a year, to praying that God would take care of him if he were a prisoner of war, and take care of any wounds he may have encountered. And so we got connected with the National League of Families, which was a group of wives and daughters and sons of prisoners that were working for the release of the families of the prisoners. Okay.
So was there ever a point where you found out for certain that he was a prisoner of war?
As I said, he was shot down May 11th, 1972, 50 years ago, and next month, can't believe that. And it was in November that the Air Force said they had covert information that Bill might be a POW. And so that made for a thankful Thanksgiving that year. And you can see on the screen up there, our daughter, Cynthia, is wearing a POW bracelet. These bracelets, the National League of Families sent out to people that wanted to wear a bracelet and remember the name of the person that was inscribed on the bracelet. And this is one of Bill's bracelets. Several people had his bracelet. After he was repatriated, we got many calls and letters, and they send their bracelet to us. And this little sticker here, blue sticker with the white star, indicates that this was a POW that came home. 550 POWs were returned from the Vietnam War. If the sticker was white with a blue star, that indicated that the person that was on your bracelet, the name on the bracelet, was still missing in action.
All right, so we'll go ahead and check back in with Bill then. How were you treated at the Hanoi Hilton?
Well, initially I was put in a room, I guess you could call it an interrogation room. And interrogation, and of course, again, I knew there was something wrong with my right arm. My left arm, when I was growing up playing basketball, it wasn't unusual for somebody to hit me just right and dislocate my shoulder a while. So I learned how to just pop it back in place by myself. And so that's what I did with my left arm. I just popped it back in. So it was okay. I mean, it hurt for a while, but it goes away pretty quickly. But clearly there was something wrong with my right arm. I couldn't really do anything with it. And so they bring you into this interrogation room and they sit you on a stool, a four-legged stool. It's only about maybe 9 inches off the floor. And the front legs are shorter than the back legs. So that you're very uncomfortable. You're always sliding off the stool. The fact that I couldn't use my right arm made it even worse. And so the routine was that somebody would come in and interrogate for about 50 minutes, 55 minutes. And then they'd leave the room and have like a 5 minute break before the next team came in. It was an interrogation. And there was about seven teams, interrogating teams, so they just rotated through them. So you saw the same guys more than once. But this went on for 3.5 days, 24 hours a day. There was no sleep, no, after a while you got sleep deprived. Of course, there's no food. They did bring in occasionally their weak tea. And of course, at this time, I'm starting to realize that, like, I'm looking at my t-shirt, you know, I'm in my underwear, my shorts and my t-shirt, and my t-shirt is completely soaked with blood. And I'm kind of wondering, well, where's all this coming from? Because I don't feel that bad. But I'm becoming more aware of I had burns all around my face and my neck. And I had a severe burn on my lower right leg. It was bad enough that it pretty much burned all the skin away completely. And so I was a little concerned about that getting infected. And there was, you know, there was no medical treatment, just this interrogation routine. Because by the time I'm in the fourth day, I'm finally thinking, because there's no restroom breaks during this time, and I'm kind of thinking, probably shouldn't have been drinking that tea because I need to go, and I was deciding where in this room I was going to go, which corner of the room I was going to go, because it was starting to get painful. And one of the things about when they would step out for that 5 minute break each time, they would tell you that you're supposed to stay on the chair. You're not supposed to get up, move around your thing. Well, as soon as they left the room, my back was starting to really kill me. It was really getting sore and everything. And I was starting to feel, you know, right after the injection, I was in shock. Other than being extremely thirsty, I really wasn't feeling that bad. Well, the shock's worn off, everything hurts. And so as soon as they leave the room, I'd slide off on the laid out on the floor on my back. Of course, they didn't like that just because I wasn't doing what they told me. Because that was really a lot of the emphasis during these interrogations were to get you used to being obedient, okay? And I didn't. I'd sit off. Well, most of the time, they didn't make a deal, but I discovered pretty quickly that when I was laying on my back, I couldn't get up again by myself because I couldn't use my arms and my abdomen was sore like you'd just done 1,000 sit-ups. So I really couldn't do that. And so most of the guys would just set me back on the chair and we'd go about the interrogation. But there was this one team, there was two of them, And they were the guys that did kind of the good cop, bad cop routine to try to get me to cooperate. Well, the guy that was supposedly the good cop, when he would come in and he'd see me laying on the floor, he was the one that would pick me up to set me back on the stool. Well, the way he would do it is he would grab me by the elbows and lift. Well, that, let me tell you, that was a real attention-getting step. When your arm is broken and it's not connected to anything, and that was probably the only really bad treatment I received the whole time I was a POW. I mean, I never felt that I got. I never felt that I was systematically culture. But obviously, I mean, that's pain that's hard to describe. It kind of just overwhelms you. I mean, you can't, your eyesight goes away, it's so painful. And I don't remember screaming, but I'm sure I probably did. And the first time he did it, he was very apologetic, like he didn't know. You know, he didn't realize. And so the first time I thought, well, okay. But in 3.5 days, this same team, you know, you see the same team 4 or 5 times. And he did it that way every single time. He'd lift me up, and the pain would be there, and then he'd apologize. You know, and again, what I don't know what the logic of that was. I suppose there was some kind of psychological logic to it, but I never knew what it was. But after 3.5 days, and I just, one of the advantages I had is at the time I was only a first lieutenant, okay? And in the Vietnamese Army, junior officers are more like NCOs in our Army, and they're not expected to know much. So they'd ask me all these questions, and I'd just go, well, I'm not sure. I think this is sort of what it was, and they pretty much bought that. Like I said, I the only other mistreatment I got was in all these interrogations, there was always a soldier standing behind you where you couldn't see him, and he carried some kind of weapon, a rifle. It wasn't an AK-47, some kind of rifle. And every once in a while, it didn't happen too many times, but every once in a while, if the interrogators thought your answer was not appropriately respectful, they'd make a little hand signal. This guy would whack you in the back of your head with his rifle butt. And he wasn't that gentle. I mean, it's enough to kind of make your things ring a little bit.
Sorry, let me ask, cut you. I'm so sorry to cut you off. Yeah, it's a fascinating story. We're running low on time. So we have to skip ahead to the day you were freed.
I am finished, because after that, then they took me out of. They stopped the interrogations and put me in this solitary room for a while, then eventually took me to a big room with a bunch of other POWs.
All right, so yeah, we're gonna move ahead in time a little bit. So what was it like the day that you found out you're going to be released?
Well, we had a lottery among the guys in my room. They said by that time, we were up to about 40 in the room. That was kind of max capacity. So we had and so one Sunday, now the Vietnamese, Sunday really is a day of rest in North Vietnam. So we all woke up about 5:30 in the morning on a Sunday, and we heard all this racket outside, and all this something going on outside. I mean, and that was totally atypical, because Sunday was very quiet, no city traffic noise or anything. Well, as the sun came up, we realized that they're replacing all the tar paper and bamboo poles that separated the central courtyard into a small area for each room. The stuff that had been there before was all ratty, and we poked holes in the tar paper and it was faded. Well, they were putting up new poles with a nice lattice work and putting up new black shiny. Well, in our minds, there's only one reason to do that. That means that the Red Cross is coming sometime in the distant future. And so we picked a lottery of when we thought we'd actually be released. Well, I figured it probably wouldn't be until the spring of 73 sometime. So I picked my sister's birthday, which is March 28th. And it turns out that was the exact day we got, you know, just flabbergasted me, because it turned out that was the exact day we were released. But the whole, from that whole time in September, on that Sunday morning when they were doing construction, because eventually they tore that all down, and things just started getting better. It was a gradual process. Things just started getting better. And of course, we didn't know it at the time, but we found out that Vietnamese thought the negotiations in September were going really well, and they would probably have to be releasing us sometime in late 72, but then something came up, that the talks all went south and it got delayed, and then we had the Christmas bombing and all that. So, but we kind of thought it was, we didn't know how close it was going to be, but it's getting close.
Well, he's talking about the December bombings, and the peace talks are going on in December as well. And I just remember that my emotions were up and down according to the media's whim, whatever was being broadcast on the news. And I would see Henry Kissinger on the news because he was one of the major players in the peace talks. And in my mind, he was an iconic figure. And when we finally met him at the White House, I was amazed at how small and short he was. But after those peace talks and they announced the peace in January, the Air Force said, you'll get a call if your husband's on the list, because he had been listed as missing in action this whole time. And so I'm watching the news, and I had two friends in Milwaukee, Colleen and Kathy, and Colleen, whose husbands were also missing. And Colleen got the happy news on the 10 o'clock news that her husband was coming home. I still hadn't had a call. Midnight came, no call. Finally at 3 a.m., I got a call that Bill was on the list. So from that point on, it was just jubilation, and it was, you know, thanking God that he had protected and provided for them.
Thank you.
Well, I'd like to say the most, probably the most relevant thing really happened when I was still a POW. I did not grow up a Christian. I would not grow up in a Christian family, but during the, while I was in solitary confinement, they brought me out. They gave me, they handed me this shovel, and they gave me the old, we want you to dig your grave because we're getting ready to execute you. Well, I told them, you know, if you're gonna execute me, I don't care what you do with my body, you dig the grave yourself. And I wasn't really, and I want to emphasize, I wasn't really being bravado, but because I knew that this senior Army guy was just an NCO, and there's no way that he would have the authority to execute a POW, because I knew what the value of all the POWs were to the North Vietnamese government for propaganda. But in that moment, I came to a realization that I was in a place where I had absolutely no control over my future. And so for the first time in my life, I prayed to God and I said, will I get to see my wife and daughter again? And I had this sense that he immediately answered, yes, you would. And so the verse that I always think of now is in Philippians, that not be anxious about anything, but everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, make your needs known to God, and the peace of God that passes all understanding shall be yours in Christ Jesus. And that's what I sensed at that moment. It's that peace that passes no understanding. I had no reason to suddenly be at peace with everything, but I absolutely was. But beyond that, of course, initially, the airplane took us away from Jialam Airport in Hanoi, and they took us to Clark, at the big hospital at Clark Air Force Base in the Philippines. What was interesting about that is that almost all the POWs, because we came out in phases, we didn't all come out at the same time, but almost universally, when we got to the hospital, we were there, typically you were there for 3 days while they checked your health and that, they started feeding you decent food and that. And almost universally, none of us slept for 3 days. I mean, in three days, I maybe slept 2 hours because we're so pumped about finally being free and the adrenaline and going. And what made that dangerous is the first group that happened to, when they put them on the airplanes to fly them back to the States, these guys finally crashed. And a bunch of them, when they got them to a station in the States where they were supposed to meet their families, they couldn't wake them up. So for me, they shot me full of something right after the airplane took off from Clark, going ahead to Hawaii. they gave you a shot of something that put you to sleep so that you got some sleep by the time you got to the States. And then, of course, my destination was Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Ohio, because that was the big Air Force hospital that was closest to our hometown in Clinton. And that's where, of course, getting off the airplane there is where I see my wife and daughter for the first time. My parents were there. And, that's where you see the scenes of my daughter being impatient for attention. She starts beating on my leg. I let her know that she wants some attention too. And after that, it's just a lot of happy times, a lot of happy pluses. The Air Force was very generous in the amount of convalescent leave they gave you. They left it up to me as to when I wanted to report back for duty. And so I didn't go back to the Air Force until August, September '73. Of course, during that time, we were invited to the White House for the big dinner at the White House. Lots of very positive, pleasant memories. Just the joy of being back to your family and somewhat normal life. Yeah, that was probably my biggest legacy. Surviving the POW, that's my biggest legacy, is all the grandkids we generate.